Thank you, Senator. Senator Fierravanti-Wells.
Thank you, Madam Acting Deputy President. I too rise to make a contribution on this bill. Well, last week we saw the worst of behaviour of big tech. It was on show for all to see, and the petulant behaviour of Facebook and what they did last week reinforces for me why this legislation is not only necessary, but that the tough stance that the government has taken in this issue, on this issue is justified. So my constituents in New South Wales were met on Friday in the Daily Telegraph, which is a widely read newspaper in New South Wales, and which with headlines such as "Face Block, Social Media Giant's News Ban Lays Bare Its Callous Disregard for Australians." It goes on to say, "Unfriendly fire hits Oz," and it looks at the sites that were blocked, which include sites of emergency services, support services, such as helplines, charities, government agencies were blocked, university research sites, commercial sites, sports sites, retail sites, arts and other sites. And there they are listed, and indeed one very interesting little headline by James Morrow was, "It's time I zucked off and became anti-social." I wonder whether after my speech this evening I too will be zucked off by Facebook and my Facebook page deleted. But of course there is the concern, for example, the newspaper also talks about how the block by Facebook was shutting the door to child abuse cops, and how Facebook would risk hindering probes into underage sex complaints. The editorial on that day was very interesting. It's headed, "True Colours Shown and They're All Bad." And it was interesting. It states that it summed up the situation very, very well, and it drew an interesting parallel between the need for Australians, particularly post-pandemic, to look at and examine decoupling from China and the dependence that we have on China, and compared that with, just like China, Australia must now find other ways to connect and be informed online. In other words, saying and drawing this parallel, China hit Australia with trade barriers and tariffs. Now Facebook has hit us with indiscriminate page purges. So it is a very good analogy, and of course I have been advocating for us to decouple from China, just as I think that the time has come for us to be other players to be involved in this space. I now look at some detail in relation to this bill. It will establish a world first mandatory code to address the bargaining power imbalances between digital platforms and Australian news businesses. Now, we know that consumers are obtaining their news more and more online, and news media businesses are now having to deal with the challenges of finding a viable and sustainable business model so that public interest journalism can be provided. But at the same time, we do see that digital platforms are thriving, with their advertising revenues just growing in leaps and bounds. And under these circumstances, it is totally unacceptable that digital platforms continue to earn revenue from news content which is created by Australian news media outlets, news businesses, without them being properly remunerated. Now, the ACCC found that this situation has arisen because of the imbalance of this bargaining power between these platforms and between local businesses. And so that's why this code seeks to find a fair and flexible way to deal with this imbalance. It will encourage the parties to commercially negotiate outside the code, and if there are processes that will be put in place if these negotiations are not successful. And so it's important to look at bargaining. It does say good faith bargaining, and also there is a process of arbitration in the event that a deal cannot be reached. The code also provides, importantly, for standard codes and publishing of standard offers, which are ways for those small businesses to avoid cost and time of going to arbitration. Now, of course, the code will apply to Facebook and Google at first, but will be expanded in future for other platforms. So there are also substantial penalties for breaching the code's provisions. I do turn, as Chair of the Senate Standing Committee on Delegated Scrutiny of Delegated Legislation, I do want to raise a number of scrutiny points which were raised by the Scrutiny of Bills Committee, and again reiterate another bill which has got substantial and significant matters that are going to be set out in delegated legislation. This is, of course, of great concern to the committee that I chair, because we do continue to see again, another legislative scheme which should be included in primary legislation rather than delegated legislation. And this was a concern that was raised by the Senate Standing Committee for the Scrutiny of Bills. And indeed, it also raised the question of the power of the minister to make determinations that specifies services as designated digital platform services and specifies corporations as designated digital platform corporations. And of course, again, this is the sort of thing that should be in the primary legislation rather than being put into delegated legislation. Because, of course, here we have circumstances where rights will be affected, and, of course, these are concerns that have been repeatedly raised, and unfortunately here we have another bill which is likely to fall foul of scrutiny and delegated legislation principles. In a recent opinion piece by Raquel Falk, who is the Chief Executive of the Cybersecurity Cooperative Research Centre, she makes some very, very valid points. And she refers to, and her piece is entitled "Big Tech Has No Claim to Moral High Ground," and she refers to the incident that happened in San Bernardino County Department, and following that, a problem emerged in relation to the phones and accessing of encrypted data. And despite the death and the carnage and the desperate search for answers that happened, Apple dug its heels in and wouldn't provide the necessary assistance to the authorities. Now, of course, recently we've seen the banning of former President Trump by Twitter and Facebook. Now, Ms. Falk makes this comment: "It is at best," and I want to quote her, "it is at best misguided altruism, but is more likely feigned in the name of wokeness. It serves to build a false sense of trust and camaraderie with users when ultimately all these platforms want is their data and their dollars. It is also virtual signalling of the highest order and of the worst kind, the type that has much more to do with the bottom line than the betterment of society, the kind that is worth billions to big tech. Importantly for all people, this must be a wake-up call, because any threat to free speech is a threat to democracy. And by muzzling Trump, these platforms have demonstrated the potential power they wield in designing discourse." She states, And I think it's worth noting this. A very important point. This power is far more immense than that of a government or media mogul. It represents a move away from social media to social engineering, algorithms over informed decision making. There is no moral high ground. And of course, we've seen what happened with Parler. And of course, Parler, the social network, which was very popular amongst conservatives, conservative users, it was plunged into internet limbo recently, facing technical, complex and a very costly path to getting back online. And Amazon booted the company from its cloud computing services, knocking it offline. Again, taking the decision of, you know, what we deem you should be reading and you should have access to. And I think that this is basically, I think Silicon Valley is silencing dissent while depriving users of free speech alternative platforms. And there was an article that was written by Spiked online editor Andrew Doyle, and not a fan of former President Trump, but nevertheless he does make some very important and very, very valid points. And I'd just like to pick up on some of them that he wrote in this article called "We Ignore Big Tech Censorship at Our Peril." The glee of seeing Trump banned has blinded left-wingers to the threat posed by Silicon Valley. And I quote, "The greatest trick of authoritarians is to convince their subjects to rejoice in their own subjugation. Over the past week, we have seen self-proclaimed leftists cheering on multi-billion dollar corporations as they ratchet up their policies on censorship and their determination to control the parameters of acceptable thought and speech." The article also states, "Big tech censorship is set to be one of the most important issues of our time, and those of us who still care about our liberties are right to be vigilant." Let us consider the misconceptions one by one. The tech giants of Silicon Valley operate a collective oligopoly over the equivalent of the modern-day public square. The article goes on to say these kinds of corporate oligopolies are precisely the reason why antitrust legislation exists in an open market economy. The way in which the tech giants have coordinated to prevent users from accessing Parler, a rival platform which was established in 2018, demonstrates that they are willing to go to any lengths to ensure that their dominance of the market is absolute. And then, of course, I would like to conclude my comments with what Twitter did in terms of banning former President Donald Trump. I thought that was absolutely appalling. I mean, I was actually pleased to see that Chancellor Merkel was very critical of that as well. And, of course, the hypocrisy of Twitter. They're prepared to leave totalitarian rulers continue to promote their bile and their vile comments, and yet they were prepared to take action in relation to President Trump, but still leave the head of Iran and letting him continue with his activities. I mean, particularly calling, as Iran does, for the wholesale eradication of Israel. Now, that's just hypocrisy in the extreme. Now, in relation to I'll conclude my remarks with some comments that were made by Spiked Online editor Brendan O'Neill. He talks about the unaccountable billionaires in Silicon Valley who switched President Donald Trump off, which is a clear and grotesque interference in democracy. He refers to this as Silicon Valley influencers switching off politicians and preventing them from engaging online. People should not underestimate just how serious this is.